Next speaker is Prof. Khaled Al-Faleh. Prof. Al-Faleh is a professor of pediatric and consultant neonatologist at King Khaled University Hospital, and he's the holder of neonatal research chair at King Saud University Medical City. Professor Al-Faleh will talk about inhaled steroid for neonatal bronchopulmonary dysplasia. Please welcome Dr. Al-Faleh.
Assalamu alaikum. Thanks a lot, Dr. Ahmad, for this introduction. I would like to thank the organizing committee and the scientific committee for inviting me for this prestigious meeting. It is quite challenging to come up to the podium after a great talk by Professor Ali, who doesn't seem to be believing in randomized controlled trial a lot. All my talk is about randomized controlled trial. So I think in the discussion we could talk about more about that experience in Colombia and the rates of PPD over there. My talk today focuses on a very focused question, is the prophylactic use for inhaled steroids for prevention of bronchopulmonary dysplasia. I'm going to have a short talk focusing mainly on the evidence and comparison of inhaled steroids to other intervention that targets prevention of pulmonary bronchopulmonary dysplasia. We're all of us working in the NICU are well aware of bronchopulmonary dysplasia. It's one of the major complications that we face in the preterm infants, and it has been there for a long time. It is multifactorial when it comes to the pathogenesis of it. The definition of bronchopulmonary dysplasia has evolved over the years from needing oxygen at 28 days, then into needing oxygen at 36 weeks corrected age. Then it was changed to a mild, moderate, and severe bronchopulmonary dysplasia based on certain criteria. And over the last 10 years, we started hearing about the, another definition of PPD, the physiologic PPD. But still, in randomized, big randomized controlled trials, the definition of needing oxygen at 36 weeks is the main definition used to define babies having bronchopulmonary dysplasia. In the old days, in the paper published by Norway almost 30 or 35 years ago, PPD in those days was completely different from the PPD that we're seeing these days. It affected large premature babies. It was in the pre-surfactant era. And PPD in those days mainly resulted from the barotrauma and the volutrauma that occurs from mechanical ventilation. Lately, over the last 20 years, we've seen more of a milder form of PPD, diffuse granular form, and it actually affects more extreme premature babies as compared to the cystic looking PPD in the old days. PPD is one of, as I mentioned, is one of the major morbidities that we face in the NICU. And it again, although except for the 5% that comes from GW, almost every paper that comes from all over the world has a higher rate of PPD still occurring all over the world. In these two papers that were published in the last 3 years, the support trial, in both arms of the support trial, the rates of PPD defined as the need of oxygen at 36 weeks was 37% in one arm and 46% in the other arm. In the CUT trial by Schmidt and her colleagues, another oxygen targeting trial, the rates of severe PPD, and I could not look up the definition of severe PPD, but I assume that these are babies with worst type of PPD at 36 weeks corrected age, was 32% in one arm and 33% in one arm. So PPD, in almost every single randomized controlled trial that we're facing nowadays, is affecting almost one-third of our babies born less than 1,000 grams. Yes. PPD is considered as a major morbidity to the preterm infants because it is associated with other bad things that happens to the premature babies. A baby with PPD requires a lot of resources in our NICUs and after discharge. PPD makes the baby require oxygen for longer duration of time, makes them more prone for ventilator-associated pneumonia. They may make them more prone for a severer form of RSV bronchiolitis. And in this data by Dr. Schmidt from her CAB trial, PPD as a single indicator was associated with a threefold increase in death or neurosensory impairment at 5 years of age. So it's a very important indicator of our performance in the NICU, and it's very important for us to try to prevent PPD in the NICUs to improve the outcomes of our premature babies. Once PPD is established, it's very difficult for us to do anything about it. We have a few interventions that we try to do with babies who are developing PPD, but very, very few studies that have proven that changing the course of PPD will do anything once the PPD is already established. So our trials should always focus on preventing PPDs. There has been few interventions in the literature that has been shown in a randomized controlled trial to reduce PPD. Some of them that we might believe that they do decrease PPD, but in fact the evidence shows the against. Antenatal steroids, although it's one of the major interventions in neonatal medicine, was able to make smaller babies survive, but overall there was no reduction in the rates of PPD. Definitely PPD is lower in the more premature babies, but antenatal steroids gives us more immature babies, therefore the rates of PPD was not lower. Surfactant is also the same. So the last four interventions in this slide are the main interventions that has been shown, in addition to adequate nutrition to premature babies, that has been shown to reduce the rates of PPD scientifically. Fluid restriction has been studied in four small randomized controlled trials. All the trials were old and small in nature. However, the rates of PPD in these trials was lower than babies who were kept fluid restricted as compared to babies who had liberal fluid intake. Vitamin A, one of the few interventions in neonatal medicine that has been proven by large randomized controlled trials to have a modest efficacy with regard to reduction of PPD. However, it's not used nowadays because of logistic reasons of the injections, the three time a week injection given through vitamin A. So this intervention, although well proven in randomized controlled trials, did not find its place into our practice. In the CAB trial in 2006, caffeine has been shown to decrease the rates of PPD. However, the rates of caffeine, of PPD in the caffeine group was 33% as compared to the 47% rate of PPD in babies who did not receive caffeine. So I do doubt that caffeine has a direct effect on the lungs itself. I think the babies who were treated in placebo got more oxygen and got more trauma through mechanical ventilation and other ways of ventilation that made them have more PPD as compared to the direct effect of caffeine itself on the lungs. Primary CPAP, when you look at the meta-analysis, yes, primary CPAP does have a modest effect in reduction of PPD at 36 weeks, although the largest randomized controlled trial by Professor Morley did not show a reduction in PPD, and we'll come back to these interventions in the last slide of my presentation. We're all aware of the story of postnatal steroids in the NICU. And postnatal steroids used to be given like water in the NICUs in the 90s. Almost every baby who was on the ventilator was given a high dose of steroids for a long period of time in the 90s. And we almost stopped using postnatal steroids since 2000 till now. But still, we're trying to come back to steroids because we don't have other interventions in neonatal medicine that can affect the outcomes of our babies. It is well known that postnatal steroids, when it's given in the first 14 days of life to the premature babies, the rates of PPD are significantly lower compared to not giving postnatal steroids. However, postnatal steroids cause our babies to have hyperglycemia, hypertension, hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, and the most alarming outcome or adverse effect of postnatal steroids is a double the number of cerebral palsy in the future. So babies who have received postnatal steroids, especially the early or intermediate courses, had increased rates of neurosensory impairment in the future. And this is the main reason why people have stopped using postnatal steroids since 2000 and onwards. We didn't stop trying to use them again by using lower doses in the DART study, by using another, just recently, another hydrocortisone study was published from France showing that small dose of hydrocortisone in the first 2 weeks of life prevents PPD without affecting the neurosensory outcomes. But we still, in our practice in the NICU, we're quite afraid of using postnatal steroids as a parenteral route because of its long-term effect, and we only use it in very, very selective cases. People tried to use corticosteroids through instillation with surfactant in the first 2 days of life. In addition, lately, another intervention came back to the picture, which is inhaled corticosteroids. And it seems very plausible alternative to postnatal steroids because it can be given directly to the pulmonary tract without having the dangers of systemic absorption and the side effects of giving postnatal steroids. Inhaled corticosteroids was studied as an early intervention as a prophylaxis in 7 randomized controlled trials to prevent bronchopulmonary dysplasia. Most of the studies that use inhaled corticosteroids were small and old. And in fact, since 2002, we did not have any new single randomized controlled trial addressing the question whether inhaled corticosteroids prevent PPD or not. Just in 2015, Dr. Dirk Passler and his colleagues published in New England Journal the largest trial of inhaled corticosteroids for prevention of PPD that included 850 babies. Because larger trials are closer to the truth, I chose to give you the details of Dr. Basil's trial and Dr. Cole's trial from 1999. Cole's 1999 trial enrolled babies less than 33 weeks, less than 1250 grams at birth, who required assisted ventilation between 3 to 14 days of life, and they had 250 babies. The intervention group received peglomethasone, dipropionate, as an MDI, and the dose was 40 microgram per kilogram per day in the first week, and the dose of inhaled corticosteroids was tapered off slowly over the course of four weeks. The control group had only placebo. It was a multicenter study, and the use of systemic steroids was permitted at the discretion of consulting physician. The most prominent trial in this question is the study that was published 2 years ago by Basler and his colleague from Europe. It was a multicenter trial from Europe, enrolled a very small babies, 23 to 28 weeks. And babies, what is unique of the study, that the babies got enrolled in the first 12 hours of age. Any baby who required any positive respiratory support was enrolled, 850 babies. The mean birth weight was 800 grams, and the mean gestational age for the enrolled infant was 26 weeks. Babies in the intervention group received 2 puffs of budesonide, 200 microgram per puff, 12 hourly for 14 days, then once daily until the infant no longer required supplemental oxygen. And the main outcome of this study was death or PPD and PPD alone. The control group received a placebo in a form of also 2 puffs with the same, and it was a blinded trial. The trial was conducted between 2010 to 2013. Now, going to the results of all the studies together, and as you can see from this first slide that looks at death or PPD at 36 weeks, the trial by Basler weighs more than 76% of the evidence that we have for inhaled steroids. So it is actually the major study that's affecting our interpretation of the evidence with regard to this intervention. Inhaled corticosteroids overall reduce the rates of death or PPD by 14%. The best case scenario is 25% reduction of death or PPD, and the worst case scenario is a 1% reduction in death or PPD. What is more impressive is this slide that shows that inhaled corticosteroids reduce PPD by 25%. The best case scenario is 40% reduction of PPD, and the worst case scenario is 7% reduction of PPD. And again, as you can see here, most of the other studies are very small, and the major outcomes is coming from the latest study published in New England Journal of Medicine a couple of years ago. In the study by Dirk and his colleague, there was a slight non-significant increase in mortality that was observed in the group receiving inhaled corticosteroids. This was not observed in any other trial. And again, other trials that include the use of systemic, more potent corticosteroids did not show any difference in mortality. In fact, babies who received corticosteroid had lower mortality and PPD in the older studies. So we do assume that this very slight increase in mortality is because of chance and not because of any other reason. Another very important outcome of inhaled corticosteroids is the success rate of extubating babies. Babies who received inhaled corticosteroids had a 40% reduction in the rates of reintubation as compared to babies receiving placebo alone. Looking at the adverse effects of inhaled corticosteroids or corticosteroids in general, there was no difference with regard to hyperglycemia. There was no difference with regard to sepsis in the both groups. And there was no difference although the data is very scattered and very small, there was no difference in the rates of hypertension. Neck was almost equal between the two groups. And ROP was also not different between the two groups. So the major morbidities did not get affected by the use of inhaled corticosteroids. So in summary, for inhaled corticosteroids, and if we want to apply an evidence-based approach in 2017 till we have further data, inhaled corticosteroids prophylactically in the preterm infants seems to have a modest efficacy with regard to the reduction of bronchopulmonary dysplasia. It seems to be generally safe. However, we do need to wait for the long-term outcomes coming out from Basler and colleagues' study. It is cheap, and it is very easy to administer, and there isn't really any issues with regard to patient preferences and values when it comes to the use of inhaled corticosteroids as compared to the use of postnatal steroids. Now, in comparison to other interventions that prevents PPD in our NICUs, and when you compare them with regard to the number needed to treat, giving vitamin A to prevent PPD gives you a number needed to treat of 14 to prevent one case of PPD. Caffeine has a number needed to treat of 10 as per the CAP trial. Primary non-invasive ventilation, including CPAP, with regard to the reduction of PPD, has a number needed to treat of 40. And inhaled steroids, based on the data that I presented to you, has a number needed to treat of 13. So it is your choice whether to jump into this intervention and start giving premature babies inhaled steroids from day one or day two, or withhold till you have further data. And thank you.
Thanks, Prof. Khaled Al-Faleh.